So first I will show you, I wanted to avoid showing pictures because of fresh air, but someone convinced me to show them. So first 5 minutes you need to suffer and then we will open. This is a nodal portrait of the model considered in the introductory part. So you take stationary Gaussian function whose spectral measure is Lebesgue measure on the unit circumference. So this function satisfies Helmholtz equation. And this is exactly what Богомольный and Schmidt studied. So black places are places where function is positive or negative, and white places are places where function is negative. So this is how this nodal portrait of this function looks like. The other picture was done by Maria Anastasescu. She was an undergraduate student at Princeton, and this was her undergraduate project last year. So this is a Kostlin ensemble of polynomials, which we were talking about before this morning. And just instead of projective space, we look at it on the sphere. It doesn't matter so much, but it's much simpler to make pictures of something on the sphere than on the projective plane. And here, by different colors, you see or you don't see zero lines. But since the number of colors is bounded, the number of lines is big, so this is a random polynomial of degree 56, and these lines are zero lines of this random polynomial. And the last picture, here you see this guy we will talk about today. This is a random spherical harmonic of degree 40. And here you see a picture, this is a random linear combination of spherical harmonics of degree from 1 to 40. And you see that this picture looks very different from this one. And the reason, in four words, this is elliptic regularity in action. Just because this function, it satisfies, this is eigenfunction of Laplace equation, Laplace-Beltrami equation. So it satisfies elliptic equation. And for this reason, it is much more regular. This function also is infinitely smooth, but this function is much more regular than this. And you see this by eye, but the principal difference that here, and this will be very important in my talk, you don't have this small nasty nodal domains, which were our problem in the very end of my talk in the morning and which I will address today. So here, all nodal domains where a function doesn't change sign, they cannot be too small. They have area bounded from below. This will be very important for us today. So you see that these two nodal portraits are quite different. So that's all. What I will not bother you by pictures anymore, and now we may start working. And these pictures are quite nice, I think. All right, so what we will do, we will look at the spherical, at the ensemble of spherical harmonics, which we were talking in the morning. So HN, this is a finite dimensional subspace. This is a Hilbert space. Of spherical harmonics of degree n, this space is finite dimensional. This is not so important. Dimension is 2n plus 1. Fn of x is our random spherical harmonics. So these are independent standard Gaussian guys. For some reason, since we agreed to have variance 1 for the kernel, I will normalize just to have to keep variance 1. And the theorem, this is the third theorem in my mini course, which I'm going to prove, says the following, that for each positive epsilon, there are constants, positive constants, which depend on epsilon, such that probability that the number of connected components of the zero set over n square deviates from the secret constant, which we already talked a lot, by epsilon less or equal than c e to the power minus. So instead of tending to zero, like we did in the from what you heard in the morning, we know that this probability tends to zero. We proved even more a little bit, but now I'm saying that it tends to zero exponentially fast. And for this, we need to change completely the strategy for the proof. And instead of this, I will prove something different. I will replace it, this by Mn, where Mn is the median for this random variable. Clearly, if we know this for median and we know already what we learned in the first lecture, that we have convergence in L1, if we have this for medians, since we already know that medians converge to this guy, it will be enough. So the proof of this is based on the Gaussian isoperimetry . This is a beautiful and very important thing, which was discovered by Sudakov and Cyrilson in 74, probably. Okay, yes. And then a year later by Christopher Borel independently. And it says,
what was the last year of the
So this was his last
It was before he became my important one.
So he was still. So Cyrilson was still master student that time, and the theorem says I believe many of you know about the theorem, but anyway, it says the following: that suppose we have a Gaussian measure on RD, let me normalize it that in a way that the variance, so this is the same as to say that expectation of x square is 1. And suppose we have a Borel set in RD, And we have a fine half space in RD. I continue here so that they have equal Gaussian meshes. Then these are assumptions. Then for every positive rho, if we look at rho neighborhoods, gamma d of sigma plus rho, this is a rho neighborhood of our Borel set. This is always bigger or equal than gamma d of pi plus rho. This is an absolutely remarkable inequality, which can be proved by many, many different ways. Now maybe there are 10 proofs, and many of them are not difficult. And I think I haven't been at first lectures of Surav talks, but since he was speaking of about concentration, I assume that he may, because without this, you cannot do. This is together with original Bernstein inequality, large deviation inequality. These are two basic things in study all concentration phenomena. Bernstein concentration, and this is what people call sometimes Levy concentration. This is absolutely basic things. So now, why it's called isoperimetric inequality, it's clear, right? Because somehow we want to minimize Gaussian measure of the belt around sigma. And extremal body is a fine half space. So this is a very simple exercise, which everyone here can do, which says that if Gaussian measure of rho neighborhood of a fine half space is separated from 1, don't take seriously 3 over 4, for me it doesn't matter which constant to put here, important thing that this constant is less than 1, then Gaussian measure of a fine half space must be exponentially small with dimension. When dimension is big, then the Gaussian measure of a fine half space will be exponentially small. This is a very simple exercise, and I do believe that all of you can do this in a very simple way. But now let us write a more immediate consequence for our, to which space I will apply it. We have space of spherical harmonics. We have a probability measure on this. So D is 2n plus 1. This is the dimension of our space. So corollary that if, I don't want to use sigma anymore, if G, say, is a some set of spherical harmonics such that probability of the event G plus rho is less or equal than 3 over 4, then probability of G must be exponentially small with n. When I say rho neighborhood, now rho neighborhood is in our metric, this is in L2 sense. So our Gaussian, our finite dimensional space is Hn equipped by distance which was taken from L2 on the sphere. So this is what we will use instead of isoperimetric instead of ergodicity. Now, should put it that way. The next step, so what I want to discuss now is a very important thing, which I called uniform lower semi-continuity. Of this function on spherical harmonics. It cannot be, so what I want to apply Gaussian isoperimetry, I want to be sure that if I perturb a little bit spherical harmonic by adding another spherical harmonic of small L2 norm, then the number of components cannot drop up significantly. Certainly, as you understand from my first lecture today, it cannot be true. We have the same enemy, zero critical values. So this title is a little bit of misleading. So to have correct title outside of exceptional set. And here is a fundamental lemma. Which says the following. Given epsilon, there exist constants, positive constants, everything is positive, and there exists a set of spherical harmonics of exponentially small measure. So that for any f in Hn without e, and for any g in Hn with norm, so if I'm not writing, now I will write L2 of S2, but I will stop writing this. We have the number of zero components of the sum bigger or equal than the number of zero components of f minus epsilon n square. So this is exactly uniform lower semi-continuity, but to get it, you need to get rid of unstable spherical harmonics for which you have many zero critical, or for which you have many critical values near the origin. It looks a little bit asymmetric. Why we have only one-sided inequality? The reason is very clear, because here I assume that function f is not exceptional, and I haven't assumed anything about g. I said that it has a small norm. If I would have symmetric condition, look, it's easy to symmetrize this. If I do non-exceptional perturbation, then I will have two-sided inequality. So first of all, let us note that from here, so now I want to explain that fundamental lemma immediately yields what I want to prove. No, well, let us consider, for instance, let's denote by G the set of spherical harmonics for which mean number of zero components over n square is bigger than mn plus epsilon. And then separately we will consider. Then if we will take rho neighborhood in L2 norm, clearly, this contains in the set where nf over n square is bigger than mn union with our exceptional set. This is by fundamental lemma. Right, because if our spherical harmonic here was not exceptional, then by fundamental lemma, the number of components cannot be dropped by more than epsilon n square. So this means that the probability that our measure of this guy, if n is sufficiently big, will be less than 3 over 4, right? This is 1/2, and this goes to 0 exponentially. This is just definition of the median. So this means by this corollary to Sudakov-Cyrilson-Borel theorem that probability of G itself is exponentially small. Since I put here large constant, I can forget about restrictions at n was. Anyway, the result says nothing about finite n. And the same, absolutely the same is for the set G prime when n of f over n square is less than nm minus epsilon. Again, you use fundamental lemma and you get this. Well, so we see that fundamental lemma immediately yields what we, together with Gaussian isoperimetry, immediately gives us what we wanted to prove. So we need to, so what remains is to convince you that fundamental lemma is correct. Still, I will use once. So this I don't need anymore. This probably I will. I want to keep only corollary to well, let's continue. So how do we prove fundamental lemma? So we will do this in several steps. First of all, I want to define exceptional set. So the first step we cover, before that, we will need several parameters. I will try to avoid this, but anyway, we need our parameters. R, big number R, and small numbers alpha and delta. And all of them are powers of our small parameter epsilon. So this guy is negative power, will be some negative power of epsilon, this will be positive power of epsilon. So on the first step, what I want to do, I want to cover the sphere by disks of radius R over N. So number of disks is like area of the sphere is 1, area of this is r square over n square, so this is like n over r squares. And then I want to use a definition. I say that the disk dj is unstable if there exists a point, I don't know, x or xj. I can write just important thing, Vincent is here. Yes, if I will choose maximum and minimum in wrong way. Maximum of a thrice bigger disk of, no, maximum from these two guys. And then minimum of a three times larger disk should be bigger, should be less than alpha. Less or equal than alpha, it doesn't matter. Otherwise, we will call our disk stable. So this is the same game as we played in the morning. Just one difference is because in the morning lecture I made scaling, so that's why there was no reason to put 1 over n near the gradient, and here I work directly with spherical harmonics. Spherical harmonics are like polynomials of degree n, so if you take gradient, you need to scale in n times. So that's why when we take derivative, we divide here by n. Before, I just put made change of variables, and n was inside this change of variables. Well, and now the second definition says that our spherical harmonic HN is exceptional if the number of unstable disks is bigger or equal than delta n square. So if, roughly speaking, 1% of the disks is unstable, if we have many different places on the sphere where function and gradient are simultaneously small. So now, the next part of the plan is to show that, is to prove this. So we need to do two things. We need to show that if we perturb unstable spherical, non-exceptional spherical harmonic, then the number of components cannot drop out significantly. And then we need to show that exceptional set is indeed exponentially small. So these are two independent things, and I can do them independently if I will have enough time. So how? So how to do this? This will be done in several steps again. So first of all, I discard all components. I denote components by gamma, which have large diameter with diameter of gamma bigger or equal than R over N. Why I can do this? Because in this situation it's very simple. Because our function is eigenfunction for the Laplacian, there is, on the sphere, it's very easy to estimate the total length. So zero set is a union of some nice curve. And the total length of the zero set is less or equal than some constant times n. This is just a fact about eigenfunctions, which is quite easy fact. You can do this, in this situation, you can do this algebraically, because spherical harmonics are restrictions of homogeneous polynomials, homogeneous harmonic polynomials in R3 to the unit sphere. So in fact, you can deduce this from Bezout's theorem. Another option is to, okay, there are several proofs, and this I will not do. Just let me remind that if you want to estimate the length of some curve for which you don't know parametric equation, the only way to do this is to take many one-dimensional lines to compute how many intersections you will have, and then to average over position of the line. And then you can apply either Bezout's theorem or some facts about analytic functions. It depends on your taste. So if we have this, this means that the number of long components is is less or equal than some constant r to the power minus 2 n square. So if our parameter r was sufficiently large, this will be less than epsilon, and we can forget about long components. So now all components are not long. We don't have long components anymore. The next step, this is B. So we have gamma, which is normal, which means that it is not long. And we take disk D, which intersect our components. We had a covering by disk, so one disk will intersect component. So the next step is I want to discard gammas that intersect unstable disks. We know the total area of unstable disks is not so big because from our function f was not exceptional, so the number of unstable disks is under control. But now we have one thing which simplifies our life very much. It's area estimate. This is a deterministic fact about eigenfunctions of Laplacian on manifolds. It has nothing very classical one. It's also in current Hilbert book and in many other places. That if our component gamma is a boundary of some domain, G I use for other purposes is a boundary. How else we denote domains? D, G,
big gamma.
Big gamma, then the area of this domain bigger or equal than some numerical constant over n square. You can even inscribe. This is exactly what you have seen in the picture when I said elliptic regularity in action, that there was no small components. Inside each component, you can inscribe disk of radius some small constant over n. This is a very simple fact about solution of elliptic PDEs. But if we, I will use this twice, and for this reason, I want to keep it on the blackboard. But if we believe into this, then the total number of these gammas that intersect unstable disks is under control. The area of each unstable disk is r square over n square. Total area, number of them is number of them is delta. So this means that the number of these gammas, just counting areas, is less or equal than delta n square. This is the number of unstable disks time times r square. So now delta, why delta square? So now this will be again less than epsilon if delta r square is less than epsilon, or much smaller than epsilon. This is just restrictions on our parameters. Okay, so now all our components after this step, all our components are not long and they intersect stable disks. So now we can use the trap which I constructed in the first lecture. So now let's make a picture. This was our disk DJ. This was our component gamma. The radius of the disk was R over N. This is a triple, 3 times larger disk, so this is 3 over N. And diameter of gamma, since we throw away long components, is at most R over N. This means that our gamma is deeply inside, it cannot come close to the boundary. The distance from gamma to the boundary is still bigger than must be bigger than R over N. So now we start our perturbation. So we want to add to gamma. So we have G. This is a spherical harmonic. It's norm is less than rho, and we want to consider f plus g. But about g, we need to know that this is uniformly small. What our trap estimate gives us. So we started with gamma, and the construction I had before break, that if we consider our disk is stable, so here we're sure that everywhere maximum of absolute value of f and 1 over n grad f is bigger than alpha. This means that what we can do by perturbation, we need that maximum of absolute value of g in the 3 times bigger disk is less than alpha. Because we can construct a trap, we can from zero level go to the level alpha. We know that, so this was the place where f was zero. This is the place where f is, say, plus alpha. This is the place where f is minus alpha. This is what I called, this topological annulus is a trap. And if I add something with maximum less than alpha, still the sum by undergraduate calculus must have zero component inside orange domain. So f plus g must vanish somewhere inside the orange domain. So that's why for if we had one component for f, we will have in these places one component for at least one component for f plus g. So what we need to be sure that this condition holds. We had L2 norm was small on the whole sphere, and we want to know that uniform norm is small in our disk. Of course, for any disk, this is not true. But what we can do, we can use again some facts about solutions of elliptic PD. So this is what we need to prove. And what I want to use the following. I want to use that if G is an eigenfunction, then for any point X, if I look at the value of g at point x square, then this is less or equal than some constant times n square times integral around x of radius 1 over n g square. Let mean value inequality for harmonic functions. This is absolutely standard fact about solutions of elliptic PD, but I can explain you why this is true. Because when we are doing the scaling, our function will be like small perturbations of harmonic functions. For harmonic functions, this is true. So for small perturbations of harmonic functions, this is true as well. So now, for how many J's, it is clear that if we have this and the norm of G was less than rho, we had these two facts. So the number of J's for which what we need doesn't hold is also small. Why? Well, first, when we had this disk, we throw away some portion of disks to make this disk separable, say, at least by 4 over n. And then we can use elementary counting. If you have this inequality, and if you have this inequality, then there are not so many disks when this will be violated. So this is the choice. This is the choice of rho. So this is the idea how we prove this perturbation, why perturbation theorem is correct. So once more, first of all we cover sphere by disks of radius large constant over n, then we call disk unstable if there is a point and three times bigger disk where function and gradient are simultaneously small. Then we throw away, then we consider only spherical harmonics for which the number of unstable disks is not too big. And then we throw away spherical harmonics for which then we throw away spherical harmonics for which there are many unstable disks. Then we need to count this component. So we look at components of F, of the zero set of F. We threw away components which are long, which have long, big diameter. Then we threw away components which intersect unstable disks. All the time we neglect by small number of components times, small number times n square. Then we constructed a trap. Then we perturb by function which has small L2 norm, global L2 norm. Then we said by mean value inequality that on the most of the sphere, on the many disks, maximal norm cannot be too large. there will be only a few disks where maximum will be large. So this is the way how we prove this estimate. So now, what I need to do, I need to show that, I need to explain why the area of the set is small. I need to decide what I can erase. Okay, it's this I can erase. Here I will do basically hand waving, but I will try at least to tell you something. So the third part, why? What I want to show that, so we had our parameters delta and alpha. This is C delta to the power minus C delta N provided that alpha is less than something small. Alpha is parameter in this estimate, and delta is parameter of how many unstable disks, how many unstable disks we had. So we have an unstable disk. This means that, okay, it's not a realistic picture. This is DJ. This is 3 times DJ. That here we have a point xj, so that f of xj is less than alpha, and gradient of f of xj is less than alpha n. This is our unstable, this is our unstable point in the disk. Now, let us consider some, I called it DJ prime. This is disk around XJ of radius some small constant over N. It could intersect if we were near the boundary. This is XJ. So this disk may intersect the boundary of large disk, it doesn't matter. But I want from the very beginning, I want to make our 3 times bigger disk a little bit separated. I can always do this. R was a large constant, so this disks DJ prime, DXJ gamma over N are disjoint. So now what do we have by, in the center of this disk, we have these estimates. And what do we have by Taylor formula? So let me call MJ is a maximum of a DJ prime. Here I want to use of the Hessian. So this is operator norm of the Hessian, say in the point x. Hessian is a matrix from the second derivatives. And what I want to use another consequence of the fact that our function was a solution of elliptic PD, that mj prime square is less or equal than some constant n to 6, so dxj 1 over n, I can use gamma over n, it doesn't matter, f square. Each time when I differentiate maximum can grow. This is like Bernstein inequalities for derivatives of polynomials. It's not something. So this follows. These are, so to say, elliptic estimates. So now, I want to sum up all our inequalities over all J's. So take a sum over J, what we get over our unstable disks, we get that this is less. These guys are, I may assume that they are disjoint, so we get that this is less or equal than n to the 6 times integral over the whole sphere. So this is n to the 6 times L2 norm of F. And now we have, what is beautiful here, that now we are in the point where I will again use concentration of measures, and I will use both Bernstein and Levy concentration of measure. So first case, suppose that norm square here, I forgot, norm of F square is bigger than 2, say. What is norm of F square? F was a sum of psi j Ej of x, so this is orthonormal guys, I normalized by 1, so norm of f square is 1 over 2n plus 1 square sum of psi j square. So we have something like n independent variables, n 2n plus 1 Gaussian independent variables, and sum of squares is bigger than 2 times the number of variables square. So by classical Bernstein inequality, so what Serge Bernstein taught us, this is exactly what is behind this large deviation principle, which we heard from Surav during his lecture. So probability of this event will be exponentially small. We cannot have sum of many independent variables which will deviate from the mean by two, say. Case two is that this guy is normal, but this means that we have many J's for which mj square is so total number of disks is like delta n square. So if the total sum is less or equal than n to the 6, so what do we get? We get the number of j's for which mj square less or equal than n, what do I need? Mj less or equal than n square over square root of delta. This number of j's will be like delta n square. Just this is still like delta n square. And here, so we have many j's for which maximum of the second derivative is unreasonably small. And at this moment, to For this, I don't have time anymore. So for, at this moment, what is strange that we appeal again to Sudakov, Cyrilson, Borelli isoperimetric inequality. If we have many J's for which maximum of the second derivative is small, we have many places where function and where function and gradient area of the set where function and gradient are small is rather large. And if we perturb a little bit by another spherical harmonic, still the area of the set will be pretty large. So what Gaussian isoperimetry told us that probability of this is very small. So here we use Gaussian isoperimetry to finish the proof. And in last 2 minutes, I will say a few words about what is open here. So one question, and here are many people who are, here are some people who are experts in one-dimensional stationary Gaussian processes. So there is one question which is open even in one-dimensional setup. So look, we our correlation for covariance for our Gaussian processes decayed only like 1/√ of the distance. And the process was, smooth. So suppose you have one-dimensional Gaussian process for number of zeros, for mean number of zeros, or for number of zeros on our process is stationary, for number of zeros on interval 0, 1, or 0, t, we have Katz-Rice formula, so we can compute. But whether we have exponential concentration? Already in one-dimensional case, this is an open question. And question is open. Process could be analytic, could be smooth. I don't believe that smoothness is too much relevant. The reason why it is open, because zeros may come quite close to each other. In general, they repel each other, generally speaking. But still, they repel, like eigenvalues of random matrices. But they repel each other not strong enough to have an event of exponentially small probability. Still, here, when we dealt with eigenfunctions, we knew for deterministic reasons that these components cannot be too close. And, but still, I believe I have some speculation. Okay, these are speculations which I even cannot say openly, but still I believe that this is true, that if you have a large class of Gaussian stationary, one-dimensional Gaussian stationary processes, then you will have for zero crossings, for crossings of zero level, you will have exponential concentration around the constant which you can compute explicitly. And this question is open, and I think it's a very interesting question. At least one definitely needs new ideas to do this. And the second question, which I want to mention, it's related to what I originally started my lectures with, motivation which came from high energy eigenfunctions. Or so we had our model, we dealt with a sphere, which is, as geometer says sometimes, which is round sphere. So our metric was a constant metric on the sphere. Let's perturb the metric. Let's consider the metric, which is very close with all derivatives to the constant one. So then eigenspace will be already, we will not have degeneration in the, if perturbation is generic, we will not have degeneration of eigenvalues. So eigenvalues will be simple. So let's consider eigenfunctions such that eigenvalues are in the range n, n plus c. C is a large but fixed constant. Then from classical Hermann Weyl asymptotic, the number of such lambdas is like n. So now I am asking whether at least for 1% of eigenfunctions, the number of connected components will be bigger than some constant times n square. Because morally, we have, before perturbation, we have a very small exceptional set when much stronger thing doesn't happen. So we perturb a little, we perturb slightly, and naive idea is that after perturbation, something remains from the picture. We don't have any randomness here, just they said that perturbation is generic, but it looks pretty complicated. I don't know how to prove this. Just because when you make small perturbation by energy, but the energy is large, everything, I don't understand how to prove this, but I believe that this is correct. But one can simplify this even more. Instead of small perturbations, you may add small random potential. So instead of looking at eigenfunctions of Laplacian, you can add potential . You can keep the metric round, but you may add, you may make, instead of Laplacian Schrodinger, three-dimensional, two-dimensional Schrodinger operator, add just small random potential. Again, spectrum will be simple, and whether something from the picture I told you will survive, I don't know. So both questions look, for me, they are looking very interesting and very challenging. Thank you very much.